a data cassette and joystick, a comprehensive teach-yourself program, plus three additional software packages. The Commodore Family Pack, now available from your Commodore dealers and major retail stores. Now that's value for money.
Are you keeping up with the Commodore? 'Cause the Commodore is keeping up with you.
My name's Carla, and I'm, you know, suck face Amanda. Well, she sucked a bogan, because guess what? So gave back our assignments. Oh, so excellent, because guess what? I beat her. Bad income, she spat blood badly. Because guess what? Mine just looks so good because of my Commodore Omega. So easy. I might do homework more often just to get Amanda. She's so furious and such a spat because she hasn't got one. Suffer chronically, Amanda. See ya.
You're watching the most exciting game you will ever see on your TV set. Telstar by Coleco, with three different games. Telstar Tennis, with digital scoring, variable speeds. Telstar Hockey, each player controls a goalie plus a forward on the other side. Oops, a goal. And Telstar Singles Handball, a game you play yourself. Telstar Handball, Tennis, Hockey, all three at an exciting low price. For great family fun, hitch your TV to a Telstar by Coleco.
How much do you think this advanced operating environment is worth? Wait just 1 minute before you answer. Watch as Windows integrates Lotus 1-2-3 with Miami Vice. Now we can take this Ferrari and paste it right into Windows Write. Now how much do you think Microsoft Windows is worth? Don't answer. Wait until you see Windows Write and Windows Paint and to listen to what else you get at no extra charge. The MS-DOS executive, an appointment calendar, a card file, a notepad, a clock, a control panel, a terminal, a principal, a RAM driver, and can you believe it? Reversi! That's right! All these features in Reversi, all for just, how much did you guess? 500? 1,000? Even more? No, it's just $99. That's right. It's $99. It's an incredible value, but it's true. It's Windows from Microsoft. Order today. P.O. Box 286. DOS. Except in Nebraska.
Have you ever borrowed a book from thousands of miles away, across the country,
gesture ahead, take next exit,
without stopping for directions,
Route 101,
or sent someone a fax from the beach? You will, and the company that'll bring it to you, AT&T. Have you ever paid a toll without slowing down? Bought concert tickets from cash machines? Or tucked your baby in from a phone booth? You will. And the company that'll bring it to you, AT&T. Have you ever opened doors?
I'm home.
With the sound of your voice?
Her car, please.
Carried your medical history in your wallet?
Your wife's going to be just fine.
So this is where we stand on the atrium.
Or attended a meeting.
I really like what you guys have been doing.
In your bare feet.
And they have a few other ideas.
You will. And the company that'll bring it to you, AT&T. Have you ever watched the movie you wanted to, the minute you wanted to, learn special things?
That's all taken from jazz.
Now any questions?
From faraway places.
Oakland?
So where did jazz come from?
Good question.
Or tucked your baby in from a phone booth? You will. company that'll bring it to you, AT&T. Have you ever borrowed a book from thousands of miles away? Across the country.
Just ahead. Take next.
Without stopping for directions.
Route 101.
Or sent someone a fax. From the beach. You will. And the company that'll bring it to you, AT&T.
Have you ever watched the movie you wanted to? The minute you wanted to? Learn special things.
That's all taken from jazz.
Now any questions?
From faraway places.
Oakland?
So where did jazz come from?
Good question.
Or tucked your baby in? From a phone booth? You will. And the company that'll bring it to you, AT&T.
Have you ever opened doors?
I'm home.
With the sound of your voice?
Her card, please.
Carried your medical history in your wallet.
Your wife's gonna be just fine.
So this is where we stand on the atrium.
Or attended a meeting.
I really like what you guys have been doing, but
in your bare feet.
I may have a few other ideas.
You will. And the company that'll bring it to you, AT&T.
Try almost anything. So when Mattel Electronics asked me to compare their Intellivision games with Atari, I gave it a try. I compared Atari baseball with Intellivision and found Intellivision played much more like real baseball. Then I compared Atari football with Intellivision. Again, Intellivision played more like the real game. In my opinion, if you try them both, there's only one conclusion you can come to. Intellivision from Mattel Electronics.
When it comes to space games, nobody compares to Atari.
Excuse me, have you compared them to Intellivision?
Intellivision?
Sure, they've got great space games, like Intellivision Space Battle.
I didn't know.
And now there's Space Armada and the incredible Astro Smash.
I didn't know.
Here, compare for yourself. Intellivision Space Games from Mattel Electronics. Once you compare, you'll know.
Hello, I'm George Plimpton. Here's an easy question for you.
Okay, Mr. Plimpton.
Which of these home video games looks more like a real arcade game? Intellivision Lock and Chase from Mattel Electronics?
Gee, if people had this game at home, my arcade could be in big trouble.
Or Atari Pac-Man?
Blinky, you look pale.
If you picked Intellivision,
you're absolutely correct. Duh.
A fly. I'll have a mutant fly. Hello, Yar. You need some protection. Ion zone. Shift chroma. Intensify. Okay, now you need some weapons. You have a formidable enemy, the Kotile. Watch it, Yar. You have a lethal drone and some other tricks up his sleeve.
All right, that's close enough to a start, I think. Let's see if I can start this thing up. There's my face. We got some music starting up. Let's check down our scene. There we go. Hello, it's me. I haven't streamed in a week or so. I kind of had a manic schedule the week before. I streamed like 5 times in 1 week. Let's check out the other cameras. Looks like we got this is what we are probably going to be working on today. Maybe a quick stream, like only about an hour. Famous last words. That's the microscope I don't have hooked up. Someday I'll remember that. I'm trying a new thing. Well, it's not a new thing. I'm trying to resume a thing I used to do in my stream, which is open up some Obsidian tabs and take notes during the stream. At some point, I probably should put this back on the screen again, but I've got like a vague agenda. There's a few things I want to do, just so I kind of have a plan for today. I don't know how legible this is on the screen, but I'll read it to you. First thing I want to do is I've got, not that, I got this thing, which this is a cool little trinket, cool little widget. Had it for a few years. I've used it to reprogram microcontrollers. I've used it to talk to my RC 2014 kit computer. It's kind of nice. It's a nice little like USB to serial interface. One thing that's annoying about it, other than it's not staying in focus on my camera, a thing that's annoying about the design of this one is to change the settings on it. You have to solder, you have to bridge these pads. Right now you can see, or maybe you can't see, but hopefully you can see, it's set for 5-volt logic and 5-volt power. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to change it to 3-volt, because I want to program some ESP8266s today in their 3-volt logic. That's what's a little annoying about this little gadget, is every time I want to change that, there's no switches, there's solder pads. So I ordered from Amazon some new serial widgets. They're going to be on the way. So I guess first things first, and my solder iron warmed up. It's going to like, I'm going to change this real quick. It's usually pretty easy to do. I just kind of like swipe the solder. Actually, I should probably put this in the helping hands. And what I'm doing this for is I have a few of these Sonoff S31 plugs or devices, and they are apparently ESP8266. How about that? Yeah, you can hear me now. It's annoying. My whole network in the shed seems to go down as soon as I start streaming, so I gotta troubleshoot that at some point. Anyway, and then since I use an Android phone for my microphone, and I use an Android phone for this camera, and I'm streaming over the network, everything's networked, and it goes down, and everything has to be restarted. Anyway, we're back. Microphone, got this camera working. I just realized this phone has a light on it, which is actually kind of convenient. So now I can not only use it as a camera, I can use it as a light. All right. Main thing I want to do here, maybe I should just put this solder up with a solder braid, clean it up. I want to make sure this is set for 3-volt logic. You can see this thing is kind of messy right now because I have set this back and forth several times and I have not cleaned up the solder. I should probably wick that away a bit. Just kind of clean these pads up. There we go. I should inspect that to make sure those are shorted. Ever think about bodging up some little switches? I have. An annoying thing about it is I've thought about bodging some switches in there, and then I'm worried about how fragile that'll be with like some switches kind of dangling off. I don't know, these things cost like $6 on Amazon, or maybe $12 for a nice one. So what I'll probably do is I'll get a few of these on hand and just like keep them at different voltage levels and label them. But I did see a few on Amazon that have jumpers or switches. This thing's like 5 years old anyways. Buy two to the power of six of them and have them in all combinations. Yeah. I also saw one on Amazon. So this has 5-volt logic. And it's got 3-volt logic. I saw one on Amazon that has 5-volt, 3-volt, and 1.8 volt. Which, that's a new voltage level on me. But yeah, this thing's been pretty handy. Handy enough that like, okay, I need to get some more. I also should bring out my bottle of alcohol so I can like scrub this thing up. But yeah, just kinda get the solder off these pads so it can start fresh. I think that's probably good enough, huh? There's a little bit of tinning on there. Yeah, because if I'm going to flash an ESP8266, they are decidedly intolerant to 5 volts and will fry. So, yeah. Okay, well, let's inspect this thing. A little shiny right now. I'm trying to tell, did I for sure break the connection on the 5 volt? I am going to grab a brush real quick. See if I can't scrub a little flux off of there. I don't know. Got a little circuit cleaner that might be able to help here too. Connection looks broken. I just want to be, well, I guess I can meter it too. I'm going to go grab some circuit cleaner real quick. Let's see, we got deoxit, we got contact cleaner. Yeah, contact cleaner is probably good enough. Get most of the grunge off. It's just a lot of fluxy grunge. Yeah, those contacts are broken. Yeah, it's still pretty sticky. Yeah, I think I can see a pretty clear break in those contacts. Of course, I scrub this with a paper towel. I'm probably just going to leave paper towel dirt all over it, or lint all over it. I've got another brush I could use. Yeah, I got a bag of these brushes from Amazon a while back. They're usually pretty good for scrubbing electronics without breaking things. I guess I could get like an actual like old toothbrush too. Nah, that's looking pretty good. It's a little sticky from flux, but I think our pads are pretty well broken. I guess now I re-add some solder. And then I can plug it in and meter it. I guess that's what meters are for. I do have some tiny switches. I don't suppose it would actually be helpful with it. Yeah. I'm tempted to put like some headers on there. What are you doing in there? You're not supposed to be in there. Yeah, like I'd be slightly tempted to solder something like this on there, but you can see it's just huge compared to these pads. Like almost any physical component I've got is huge because of how tiny this board is. Oh well. All right, I'm just gonna do the solder pad trick. And then maybe this, it will permanently be my 3-volt 3-1. I'm gonna use some smaller helping hands here. I got these little, these are kind of neat. I've got this on my workbench. It's just a little metal plate that gaffer taped down. And I've been trying to think if I want to get some more of these. These are helping hands that are, I got like a little, well, ooh, that's dirty. But they got little magnets. Oh no, I guess it's just the paint coming off. But they got magnets on them. So I can clomp it down to this metal plate. Hello from Easter time zone, Mr. Skippy. Mr. Skipford J. Welcome back. Glad you found me on my my random streaming schedule. I think I am overcomplicating this, but I just kind of want to get it stable in the camera, get it stable for my hands. There we go. You can see what I'm doing, and I can see what I'm doing, and everybody's happy. Yeah, good enough. So all I'm doing here, I'm just going to blob a little solder on the 3-volt pads. It's funny because it's intentionally switching these pads, which is usually a thing I try to avoid. All right, that was quick enough. That was easy enough. I just really wanted to clean it up, though, since I've been like switching these pads back and forth over and over again. But yeah, so you can see this is how this gets selected. You can kind of see from the shadows that the 5-volt side is now cut. And now I got two little blobs on the 3-volt side. Alrighty then. So now, I'm just hook this up to USB, and my computer just did the blink, the bleep bleep thing to say it recognized it. Just want to be sure I got the right voltage now. Also got a text from the missus saying she's going for a walk, so that's cool. Let's go to the overhead camera. Now we can see. You should be able to see that, I think, vaguely. Yeah, you can kind of see my meter. Righto. The other thing that I just got a while ago that's kind of neat are these. So I've got this. I've got these leads on my meter, which are nice because I got the little hooky bit so I can grab on the pins. But then I also got these probes I'm gonna use for programming. These lead into just like plain old this is not showing up on the camera very well. There we go. These little leads that have little kind of like breadboard compatible DuPont and thingies. So that should be good for the programming task I'm going to do today. So the first thing we can do I'm going to take the red and the black one here. Get our helping hands out of the way. We don't need that so much anymore. So we got this thingy. Black for ground. It's going to go here. Red for power is going to go here. Back to the overhead. Now, if we make these probes kiss, you should be able to see that I changed the voltage properly. It looks like we do. We got 3.322, which is correct. So that's the voltage level. Next is the logic level. I don't know why I have these colors reversed. There's some standard colors for serial on this FTDI thing, and I don't remember what they are. It looks like blue is for receive, green is for receive, if it's either of those. Anyway, what I want to do here, I wonder if my oscilloscope would be good for this. So I want one of these in transmit and one of these in receive. And the reason why I'm assembling this is I've done this before. You'll see when I get the device I want to reprogram apart, it has little pads on the edge of the circuit board, and I'm going to hook these little hooks on the pads to give the serial device access to it. How do we measure? Let's try this. This is probably stupid. I want to see what voltage transmit is going to give me. And this is probably something I should measure with an oscilloscope. I got putty open. Ooh, that's huge. Putty is open. This has still got stuff on it from my last session with the RC2014. You can see when I hit keys, the little red light goes blinky blinky. It's kind of hard to see with that light on, but you can see there's a red light. What I want to do, let's see, I hooked up blue to transmit. I don't know if this is going to work. Can I measure the voltage of the transmit with my multimeter, or do I need an oscilloscope to catch how fast the pulses are? I may need an oscilloscope. Oh, wait. Oh, I see. Okay, well, it measures 3.3 volts already. So that's at least the right voltage. Huh. I didn't think that those pins were normally high. I don't know. Hi, hello there, children. Welcome to the stream. Hopefully it's entertaining to watch me bungle through all this. At least half of the reason for this stream is so I can see where I went wrong later when the things I'm doing don't work. So. All right. I metered it. The voltages didn't look terrible. I think I'm pretty satisfied for now. So, on to the next exciting part of this. I'm gonna unplug this real quick so I don't short any wires. But this is the monstrosity I have right now. I've got, this is the serial interface. And then I got an octopus, well, half octopus of probes that I'm gonna use in a minute. So we'll just kind of set this out of the way for now. Maybe back here. So this is the main show of this stream, I think. These are like $8 on Amazon. And what's cool about these is they control an AC outlet. Inside is an ESP8266 microcontroller. It's already flashed with some firmware from the manufacturer, but we really don't care about that firmware. I think it works with like Google Home and other crap. I'm using Home Assistant. There's a little pamphlet I don't care about. I'm just gonna recycle this box. I got four of these right now, and I wanna reprogram them. So. Well, the first things to see about this, actually what would be, what I think would be cool is I had a few web pages. You saw that in the store and wanted to take care of yourself. Yeah, it's actually, famous last words. I've done two of these already, but it was months ago, so hopefully I can remember how to do it again. They weren't too hard, but I want to, in my notes here, I want to say this was a page, and this was a page that I found useful. Da 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 da. Put that there. Da-da. Yeah, so this is kind of a preview of what I want to end up doing. But first I'm gonna disassemble this thing. Uh-oh, what is this? I don't think this is, I clicked on a YouTube video. Anyway, this guy soldered the wires to the board, but I'm just gonna use these little probe hooks. So first things first is to get the thing apart. So this is my device, same device. There's some instructions for doing this. It's kind of a neat little assembly. Let me get my iFixit brand toolkit open, and then I can start to get into this thing. If I recall, first things first is to pry off the edge cap. So that's this thing. You get a little spudger, and I think it just clips in there. Oh, it sure does. It just flew across my workbench. We do want that later, so keep that here. So popping that off reveals this end. That's the ESP8266 reset switch at the end. But once you pop that end cap off, there'll be a couple rails here that slide out. And then that reveals a few screws. Now I'm gonna have to find out which screwdriver is good for that. Probably this one. But yeah, I got a couple of these in my basement right now controlling, one is actually controlling an arcade machine, and the other is controlling some UV lights, because we've got some like black light stuff in the basement. Is that the right screwdriver? Yeah, that's gonna work. Now the funny thing is, I haven't even powered this up yet. That's how little I care about the firmware that's on it. Surprise, the thing isn't plastic welded closed or anything. Yeah, I am too. Like, surprisingly an open device for tinkering. I mean, you gotta be careful because it plugs into mains voltage, but almost like they knew people would want to do this. Yeah, they seem to have Sonoff. It's kind of like a lesser known brand, but they seem to have a variety of products based around A26X and stuff like that. And they kind of like look the other way at everyone who plays with them. All right. I got those screws out. Yeah, like those routers that were basically, yeah. Let's see, continuing the instructions. Yeah, you take the screw, remove the three screws, which are now exposed, extract the back panel. Yeah, so now, flip this thing over. Basically just, there we go. So that's the front panel, it's just plastic molded. This is the scary bit. You can see kind of the beefy electronics here, the handle wall voltage. You got a relay there. This is where the plugs, of course, go in. These are pretty skookum, these are pretty solid. But none of this is anything I want to mess with. What I want to mess with is over here. Hidden under this board, which I don't think I need to actually pull it out of this plastic housing. But hidden on this side of the board are the pads. So like that's not even hidden at all. As soon as you disassemble this thing, you can see these are the FTDI serial pads. And what's neat about this is normally this thing gets voltage from the wall itself. Like it powers itself, it's got its own power transformer in here. But to program the chip, I can give it 3 volts here. So I don't have to plug it into the wall to program. And that's where the little octopus comes in that I just carefully metered out. So this thing is a USB to serial thingy. And then these are what I'm gonna hook up to it. So, see if I can arrange this so you can see it on camera. We got ground is this one at the far left. So then, if I can get it to go right, these little hooks can go like this. And if I can get the hook to stay, which I usually can, that's enough contact usually to start the programming. So then there's ground. There's voltage. Again, just 3 volts. And it's a little physically crowded there, so I may flip it the other way around for the other pins. I don't know. No, they're not on the other side. Okay, so this is where I get confused. I have transmit is blue. So I think that means it goes to receive on the board. And make sure these don't touch. And then I believe receive on the serial interface goes to transmit on the board. Now it's a little touchy, they're spring-loaded. These can like pop off whenever they want. I guess that means it's a little touchy and I want to make sure it's physically stable before I do too much in terms of reflashing. Because I don't want it all to pop off when I'm in the middle of it. Are those the right pins? I think so. There's a couple other receive and transmit, but yeah, well, I got 4 of these to do, so we got 4 chances to screw them. Now to go back to the webpage I'm looking at, you can see, okay, yeah. As this blog post says, we swap transmit and receive between ports. And so he's basically got the same connections here as I have Yeah. I believe so. Cool. Now, here's the cool thing. Here's the really cool thing. I'm using the wrong browser for this. I'm using Firefox. Unfortunately, Firefox doesn't support web serial or web USB. I'm sad about that. Because I do have Chrome installed. Here's the really cool thing I think about all of this, is you can program this from a web browser, if I remember correctly. You can specifically program it from a Chrome web browser. So I'm gonna be a traitor against Firefox for now. Yada, yada, yada. Where are we at? Okay, program it, reflashing the sun off S31 with Tasmota. Web installer is located here. Oops. I think I might have just accidentally not accepted something. All right. Connect the ESP to your computer using USB serial. But yeah, so like in the past, I'd have to flash this kind of stuff with like the Arduino IDE or ESP tool or something like that. Let me see. Actually, I'm curious. I've got PuTTY open. I noticed some blinking lights when I plugged this in. Bring this, So I'm just plugging the serial in. Oh, I see what's gonna happen. The promising though thing is, I don't know if you noticed that on camera. A promising thing. When I plug this into USB, there's some activity on the lights, which I think means a sign of life from this beastie. I'm just being tedious about this. I'm wondering. If I can get this thing to reset in programming mode. Now, I'm probably not gonna see anything in PuTTY. Let's disconnect that real quick. And just close that. So the annoying bit about this is some of these connections are kind of tenuous. So I'm trying to get, probably see this here. I want to press this button as I apply power. As you hold down this button, hopefully my thing's done. You hold down this button and you apply power. And it goes in the programming mode, hopefully. So I think it's in programming mode. I don't see an LED on the board to tell me that. There are LEDs on the thing, but we'll see. Maybe I'll be lucky and find that. Oh, I have two serial ports. I wonder. It says I have two serial ports. I wonder which one is the one I just connected. Why do I have two serial ports? I'm trying to remember what I have plugged in that will give me two serial ports. Well, one way to find out, which serial port goes away if I unplug it. Okay, CH340. I'm trying to remember what device is CH340. Yeah, it doesn't matter right now. What I do know is when I plug this in, device manager tells me that I have COM port 5. But yeah, it's pretty cool that they exposed both the programming pins and the reset button. Which one did I just say? I think I said it was Comport 5. Yeah. Comport 5. Am I going to have been this lucky? Nope. Okay. This is an annoying part. So I need to, like, reboot the device while holding the button. I remember this being a problem before. I needed three hands to, like, get the thing just right. Error break received. Serial port isn't ready. Does it keep disconnecting the serial port? On port 5. Reset device. Oh, I see lots of lights go. Okay. I see lots of lights blinking on the serial interface. Maybe you can see them too if I'm very careful. Yeah, there we go. So, try not to disturb things. You can't really see it, but you can see the red light going, and there's occasional green light blinks. And it's programming it. Now, if I don't touch anything, hopefully I don't knock things over and, like, screw this all up. Nice. 79%. I was worried this wasn't going to go this long. Because I've done it before, but it's been months. And I was afraid this wasn't going to just work. Which is cool because I got three more that I want to do this to. So hopefully this works. Installation complete. Okay. Well, now it happens. Can I just reset it? No. All right, well, let's try this, because I'm hoping to see some signs of life in the console. Terminal disconnected, framing error. Okay. Well, yeah, and the other thing, I got to get connected to my Wi-Fi. That's why I want to get into the console here. Terminal part is not ready. So connect. Yeah, connect to COMPORT 5. Oh! That's different. So now, this thing, this web page, since it's installed the Tasmota firmware, now it's telling me it can connect, and it's telling me what version of Tasmota is on here. And it's telling me what version of chip it is, which is an ESP8266EX. So we're installed. Can't reach it. Let's change Wi-Fi. Awesome. So that is my Wi-Fi router. I don't think you'll be able to see my password. Yeah. Nice. Hopefully it connects. Because if it connects, the other cool thing about this is this has a web interface. Yeah, look at that. It's working. So, that worked. I thought it was going to be much, much harder, and cross fingers the rest of them are that easy. But now this little thing It's powered up from the pins that I got here, but I'm gonna put it back together in a second and plug it into a wall socket, and this should come back up. I got my Wi-Fi. The other thing I probably should do is go into my router and give this thing a permanent IP address on my network. But this is another thing that, like, that I think is crazy, is that, like, I'm an old person, and I, like, remember when web servers were giant. This tiny thing has a web server on it. Are there ways to reconfigure Wi-Fi without breaking open the case? I don't think so. Well, maybe. I want to say once this is flashed with Tasmota, it can do a captive portal thing, or it can do its own SSID. A lot of these A266 widgets will broadcast their own, like, private access point, and you can connect to them, get a captive portal web page, and then set Wi-Fi details. But this is on my Wi-Fi now. Configure module. Yeah, no, that's cool. This is a Sonoff S31. I know there's some configuration to do. The other thing that's cool too is if you can get to them, there's still some GPIO pins that you can do some cool stuff with. I don't bother. Let's see, I've been streaming almost an hour. I might have to sign off in like the next 20 minutes or so. But I wanted to at least get to this point. And also now I kind of want to get to the point where and show this connected to Home Assistant. Let's see. I don't think I'm like giving away too much here. Anything that's like secret information. This is not going to connect to the internet. This is just connecting to my LAN. It's got a little console. There's messages happening. Okay, well, you know what? Here's the thing I want to do. What is your I'm trying to remember if it's MQTT that I have to set up. I may dig into my Home Assistant panel and hopefully I don't like dox myself on stream, but to figure out how I set up the other two. Web admin password, yada yada yada. Let me give this a name. I'm gonna call this Tasmota. This is the third one I've done, so I'm gonna call it Tasmota 3. Tasmota 3. I can change this at some point. I have two others on my network. Okay. So since this has an IP address and every and all that fun stuff now, can I get the MAC address for this bugger? That's what I really want. I want to find the MAC address. Because if I can find the MAC address, I can go into my router and do like a DHCP reservation. And they probably don't need to do all that. So its last IP was 107. It'll probably have that IP when I come back to it. All right, let's get it out of this rig. Because right now it's just very temporarily powered by all this stuff. Maybe you don't need to see the back of my hand there for everything. Okay, so there it is. I'm going to reassemble it. Because then what I want to do is power it from the wall. So do I have it? Oh, I have it upside down. But yeah, best to get it entirely reassembled before we do any shenanigans with wall power. These are apparently UL certified too, so for whatever that means. So this isn't like a totally generic fire hazard, one hopes. I've also tried flashing another firmware called ESP Home to these, and I haven't had much luck. I might try that with one of the other three that I've got. And my main goal with these is at least two of them. I've got some lights in my kitchen that I want to come on at sunset. And there's easier ways to do this, but Home Assistant will give you an automation that you can like make something happen at sunset. I've also got I've got a remote control for blinds that I want to reverse engineer and make the blinds come down at sunset. Firmware isn't specific to this device. Yeah, no, it's specific to ESP8266 microcontrollers. And this one just happens to have that in it. Switching functionality exposed to GPIO. Yeah, it's there's the relay that's in there, I think, is just on one of the GPIO pins. A really pretty simple device. It's just got a little microcontroller in it, and hopefully I don't break this putting it back on. Yeah, just got a little microcontroller in there. Controls a relay. It's kind of the thing you'd be able to build yourself, except it was $7. So I didn't build it myself. I paid $7 to have someone else build it for me. Okay, so this is back together. Let's plug it into a wall socket and, a power strip anyways, and see what it does. Hopefully that's not the end of the stream. Now we got some other things plugged in here I need to move around. Hopefully I don't unplug the stream. Oh, but I did unplug my monitor. Oh well. We'll figure that out. I think I'm still online, yeah. All right. So, I've plugged it into the power strip, the monitor came back online, everything is good. You can't really see it. You might be able to see it. Let me bring my camera around. And hopefully not give everyone vomit. All right, toggled the LED off. Oh, and it's upside down. Oh, well. The important thing that I wanted to show, I unplug it, I plug it in, and a little light starts blinking as I think it's trying to get on Wi-Fi. That's a good sign of life. Okay, I think it's on. Well, now let's see if we're online. Cool. Yeah, all right. So it's disconnected from my little pogo pin or like grippy claw serial interface. Now it's just plugged in on its own. It has booted back up into Tasmota. I can get to all the things. Awesome. You know what I did not prepare is something to plug into it. So what do I have out here that's worth plugging into this thing? Let me search my garage really quick for something to plug into this. I clearly planned this out as I'm trying to figure out how to make my my camera look at this stupid thing. There we go. And it's upside down, but whatever. I'm gonna go to the other side of my garage where I think I have a lamp? Maybe? Huh. Yeah, if I were smart, I would have brought out just a little lamp or something. Because I know one of the things I can do here, I think, you can... I want to say you can just turn the thing on and off. from this interface. At least I thought you could. Plug in the monitor that I unplugged that? Yeah, well, I need to use the monitor to see what I'm doing. I almost did that. Oh yeah, the other thing this does, oh, that's the other cool thing about this. It isn't just a relay, it also has power monitor. So you can turn a thing on and off, and then it can tell you how much current that thing is using. Which, what's cool about that is in Home Assistant, you can use the current consumed as a rough indicator of what the thing is doing. So people have used that to like estimate, like they've hooked a washing machine up to one of these. Because this is supposedly rated for 15 amps, which is fairly heavy duty. I don't know if I'd trust a washing machine to it or something, but you can like trust, you can plug different things into it. And when that thing stops using so much current, you can get it to send you a notification that the cycle is done, whatever. What else do I have out here? I mean, okay, I don't know, this is dumb. I found another power strip. The power strip has a light on it. This is dumb. The power strip has a light on it. You will see when the power strip light lights up that I have turned on the power. I guess. Well, shoot, I swore there was literally a thing here to turn the power on and off right from the module. Okay. So yeah, I was in the configuration menu. I forgot that there were other menus here. So yeah, okay, here we go. So you can see the light on the power strip. And when I click this, it goes off. On, off, on, off. So yeah. So now this will control any AC device. Pretty cool. Over Wi-Fi. Not using anything like Matter or Zigbee or whatever. It's just a Wi-Fi device. Which is good enough for like nearly everything. Home Assistant. I wanted to look at integrating this or getting this registered with my Home Assistant. What did I just drop? Oh, that was a plug. I think I'll spend like another 10, 15 minutes and see if I can show this thing working with Home Assistant. I have too many browser windows open. Okay. Home Assistant. This is on my LAN. I don't think I'm like gonna reveal secrets if I show you what's going on with my Home Assistant. Oh, that's right. That's a Chrome browser. I'm like, why can't I drag this tab into this browser? You know what? Actually, I am gonna open that in Firefox because that's where all my passwords are. So I use the Chrome browser to install the firmware, but I like Firefox for everything else. Let's see. To Home Assistant. I guess if you're ever on my local area network, you'll know where my Home Assistant. Thought I had a password set up for this. Is that it? That was it. Cool. Logging into Home Assistant. I got a few things here. I don't have a really crazy Home Assistant set up. It controls my Nest thermostat, controls a few other things. I gotta do an update, whatever. That's it. It might be MQTT. I'm gonna read this this article a little bit more. Maybe it's not this article I'm looking for. So this is the reflashing. I reflashed it. Networking configuration. I set up the network. I told it what type it is. Yeah, MQTT. MQTT is commonly used to connect smart plugs to Home Assistant. I think that's how I set up my other ones. I'm trying to remember the web interfaces for the other ones because it'd be cool to compare configuration. Off camera, I am looking at my router configuration on another monitor because I don't want to necessarily share that. We do have a few Tasmota devices already. Let's see, this one is 107. I have another one at 102, right? Cool, yeah, okay. So this was an existing one that's in my basement right now, and I guess I called it S3101. So maybe to follow my naming naming scheme, I'm gonna call this one, if I can. Maybe I can only call it that during the initial setup. Yeah, device name, I'm gonna call it S3103, because I know I have two of these already, and this is the third one. Okay, so there's Sonoff S3101, here's 03, no, Bitwarden, I don't remember that. What I wanna do. Oh, interesting. There's something different here. Oh, there's a... I have not upgraded this in a while. Okay, 13.4. Oh, I see. Okay. I have not upgraded my other Sonoff switches. So this is 13.4.0. This is 12.4.0, major version. I should probably upgrade. Yeah. So let's look at configuration. Okay, that looks right. So, under configuration in MQTT, and MQTT is what? Message queue something something. It's used for a lot of these IoT devices. My Home Assistant is at .236. So it is MQTT that I'm doing this with. So I'm gonna take the configuration from S3101, put it in here. Oh yeah, and I can see a few other things. Like this has some ID stuff. Calling it user MQTT. What else might be changed here? Not much else. So maybe this is all I need to do to get it integrated in the Home Assistant. Let's see. Go over here in Home Assistant. Already configured, only seeing, okay. Usually, so this Tasmota thing, I think, will often just find the devices auto-magically. Yeah, so I got two switches already in the basement. Let me see if I can add another one. Already configured, only single configuration. Okay, so this is the part I don't remember. How do we add a device to Tasmota? MQTT broker and MQTT integration supported features, yada yada yada. I know. Configuration to add it. You must also configure each Tasmota device's MQTT settings to communicate with the broker. Pretty sure I did all this. Did it work in the first place? If using Mosquito Broker, create a Home Assistant user password. I don't think I gave it a password, which is kind of maybe not a great idea. There is an MQTT user. It's active. Yeah, I don't know if I gave it a password. Okay, well, whatever. Let's keep reading. Well, that was annoying. I don't know how long that was offline, but my mic has been down for a while. I need to set up an alert that tells me when I've been muted for too long. Anyway, I am just looking for configuration garbage. Removing devices. I'm trying to figure out how to add and discover the device. This says, once you configure Home Assistant integration, set option 19.0. I don't know what that means. What is set option 19? This is the point of the show where I just kind of randomly shotgun browser tabs open. New Tasmota native auto discovery install blah, blah, blah. Set option 19. I don't know what set option 19 is. Set option 19. Maybe I need to reboot the thing. I don't know. Mm-hmm. Oh, it sounds like possibly things have changed in the firmware since the last time I set this all up. Let me restart it real quick. I guess what I'm hoping is for our Home Assistant to just find it, which it often seems to do. It sees two devices already. Okay, this is online. Console says, okay, failed to connect to that. It's trying to connect to Home Assistant. It's not managing to do it. I don't know why. This could be a thing I try to do once I get into the house. Yeah, so this thing is already talking to Home Assistant. This one is already talking to Home Assistant. That's nice about this, this one that's already programmed, is it's already telling Home Assistant all kinds of things about its voltage and current and all that. I wonder what would happen if I restart this one. I'm interested to see what the console messages say. Okay, so let's start it up. It attempted a connection. It successfully connected. MQTT. So the existing sign-off is connecting. I don't know why the other one isn't. Could be a difference in firmware. Web server active. That's the other thing to check. Yeah, maybe like another 5-10 minutes. I may wrap up the stream because it's about dinner time, but I've had some successes so far in here. I did manage to flash the firmware. So at least I remember how to do that. Getting it connected to Home Assistant is kind of the next challenge. But if I can do that, I've got three others that I want to do this to, so maybe that's another stream and a half. So yeah, these settings are all the same, except for password. I don't remember if I set a password for this thing. I probably should have taken better notes. I should have been taking notes all during this stream, which I meant to do, but I kind of got caught up in doing the thing. So yeah, no idea, get hackable devices like this. Yeah, this one I had just happened to hear about, and it seems about perfect for some things I want to do. Before I wrap up, I can show you exactly what device it is. I guess I'm kind of doxing myself with my Amazon purchases here, but I don't care. Yeah, it's this thing. Well, $8. Or a 4-pack for $34.99. But is that a deal? Yes, maybe. Yeah, so like, they're usually about like $8 on Amazon. And it's funny because I think if you look at the also commonly bought with, oh, maybe not commonly bought together. I want to say there was a listing for this where you looked at the like often bought together and it was like the Sonoff, these little, you get the outlet, you get these little things and you get the cert. I was like for a while there, it's like these all came together in Amazon. So yeah, all right, gotta run. Yeah, okay, I think I should run too. It's not a fully satisfying conclusion because I didn't get it working with Home Assistant yet, but I did get custom firmware installed and I can turn a power strip on and off. So that's a pretty big success. I might come back around tomorrow to play with this some more, but until then, thanks to everybody who's been watching. Thanks for watching me bungle through this. We'll see what I get up to next stream. See you later.